Hello and welcome back to another episode of the Traders Brawl podcast. I'm Adel, the host, and today I have a special guest with me, Samir Jezzini from SupremeFX. We are here to speak about entrepreneurship. We're here to learn, and especially in the space of Web3, but also not just Web3, fitness, business, all things that require that, you know, entrepreneurs need the drive to succeed. So it's not just about entrepreneurship, as we know. It's also the mental awareness, the mental fitness at home, and how you have time for yourself, for oneself. So we're here to learn, and this is what we're about as an agency. So with that said, I'd like to, you know, invite Samir to the stage and speak. Say a few words, introduce yourself.
First of all, thank you, Adil, for having me today. I'm really excited and thrilled to be here. I'm Samir Jezzini. I'm the CEO and founder of SupremeFX. SupremeFX is CFD's trading platform. We offer more than 500 instruments. You must have heard a lot about the Forex industry, crypto. We offer all those assets for you to trade, mainly. I'm a chartered wealth manager. I've been in this industry for over a decade, manage more than $50 million asset under management. And I would say more than the stressful part about it is that more than 50% of those assets I was actually trading. So I didn't diversify it quite extensively into the real estate and more safe assets. It was actually in the high risk assets.
Right. Now, when it comes to, you know, Forex trading and, you know, this industry of trading, many people have their opinions about it, saying that it's like a casino. You know, you're literally trading based on luck and based on markets, which you cannot predict. What do you say to that?
So basically, for 90% of the people who lose their money, I would say I agree. It is because of you. You see, I always compare it to a war, to a battlefield, okay? Or to the gym. When you go to the gym, most of us work out almost the same exercises, but it's little of us that follow a diet plan.
Right.
So it's 90% diet. And similarly is trading. We might all of us have good technical knowledge, how to analyze the charts, but it takes 90% of your efforts to be put in your emotional, you know, structure and your emotional balance, because that's where the real money is made.
That's a really interesting number there, 90%. Is that true? So in terms of, like, when it comes to trading, let's say Bitcoin or let's say Apple stock, you're saying 90% comes from, would you say research, 90% comes from, it has to be like conviction, and some of it may not be always right. How do you get to that 90%?
So as I mentioned, it's 90% emotions, right? You see, it comes with confidence. Confidence comes from preparation.
Yeah.
So if you are prepared and you know the setup you've entered, there's a higher chance that you're going to be emotionally stable and stick to your convention.
Yes.
You get my point?
Yeah.
So this is where the work comes in, and this is where you need to do fundamental and technical analysis.
Right. What's the difference between the two?
Now, fundamental analysis is all about checking the balance sheet, checking the assets, checking what the company has in its box, in its black box, and understand the company, its leadership, its balance sheet, its profitability, its EBITDA, a lot of factors we take into consideration. Talking about stocks, if you talk about gold and Forex, you also have to look at the value of that asset when you are trading it in terms of fundamental analysis, and looking at the economical factors that impact it. Let's talk about gold, for example. Gold is impacted by geopolitical tensions, interest rates. So if you don't know that, you wouldn't know the direction, the long-term direction of it. Whereas technical analysis allows you to analyze the charts and have a good entry. Often do traders enter, let's say they are bullish on the Apple stock, speaking of Apple. They might be right, but they might enter late or they might enter too early, that psychologically they cannot bear seeing a drawdown on their account. Although they are right, like after 5 years it might go up again. But emotionally they couldn't handle it, seeing their account getting depleted and they see the loss drawdown, they exit the position.
That's true.
This is what technical analysis helps you with. It helps you analyze the entry point so that to a certain extent, you know at what point to enter the market. Look, I don't want to elaborate too much because I guess you have a lot of questions, but let me give you one thing. In terms of technical analysis, when I look at the candlesticks and I'm analyzing the charts, I analyze human psychology. Mm-hmm. I look at the charts as human beings. As I said, 90% is psychology, 90% is emotions. Mm-hmm. So for you to predict the next move, you would have to predict what would the, sorry to say this, but what would the sheep in the market tend to do at this point? Mm-hmm. So that I can take a position next to the big financial institutions who will most probably take advantage of that move of the herd, mm-hmm. so that I'm on the winning side.
That's a very interesting concept. I think that's the way to see it. And the issue here with retailers is that we are not as connected as institutions. Institutions are very well connected. They have many people on speed dial that they can just ring up and manipulate the markets. And even governments, they're very tied to governments, especially if you work for BlackRock. If you work with governments all the time, you can predict the next law that's going to come out. You are in constant communication with them. And people in the government side, they can also trade on the laws that they're about to put out. They have so much insider information. And we retailers don't have that. We are trading, you're right, on emotion, but also on the limited information that we have, right? If you're able to beat them, which is beating the market, then something is wrong with you. What do you think?
Look. First of all, you said a very important point that this is a net zero game. So if you are making money, someone else on the other side is losing. It's a market of liquidity, buyers and sellers. You will not be able to buy something no one is selling, right? So yes, there's a lot of insider information that, look, I don't want to jump into conspiracy theories.
Please do.
And I don't want to start talking about how BlackRock has insider information, how the government actually, during COVID, they gave the mandate to BlackRock to do the, you know, the quantitative easing and buying back of assets, which is a bit mind-boggling. Like, how could a private entity be able to be so connected to the government and be handed such a mandate? But let's stay from there. Let's come to the retail side. Mm. What can I do about it? Mm. First of all, the market makers, it's not like they have a button that they can press and they can just move the market. Mm. Warren Buffett said once, if you are handling $1 million, it's not like he is handling $130 billion. The liquidity available for $130 billion is not possible because at $1 million, how many stocks, let's say ordinary stocks you want to buy in Apple? You have a limited number of stocks you can buy. But he has 130 billion that he needs to manage. So he cannot put 100, if he's bullish on Apple, he cannot put the 130 billion all in Apple. Regardless, right or wrong, but even liquidity is not available to do that. Unless he has a big chunk, and I don't want to jump into too much finance, how it's an aggressive takeover and so forth, mm-hmm. but it's not available, right?
Right.
So the market makers need to create this liquidity. They need to create a lot of buyers to be able to sell. So those market makers hunt the stop losses. So I always tell the retail traders, put your buy limits or sell limits where you expect the majority of the retail traders to put their stop losses, because that's where the market makers will move the market to grab liquidity, liquidity sweeps, to take a move in the market because they need liquidity. Sometimes I can predict a move in the opposite direction because I see there is a gap that has not filled up, for example, and I take a bullish move just because I know market makers need liquidity, so they'll tend to bring up the price, grab all those stop losses from up there in order to pull it back down, to create that liquidity, to create that move in the market.
Wow. And this is, do you believe there's market manipulation that exists?
It's not about believing, this is a fact. Mm-hmm. We can see, don't quote me for it, you have to check, Google it, I don't know if you have Google here. I think Morgan Stanley did a precious metals market manipulation in 2000, I can't remember which year, we have to Google it and check, of more than $900 million. it's budgeted in. They manipulate the market, they make a billion, and they pay a penalty of half a billion. You booked half a billion. As I said, I don't want to jump into conspiracy theories, but this is what actually happens in the markets. There is manipulation, but that's why you have a stop loss and you need to have proper risk management strategies, because it's a game of probability, okay? And it's about discipline. So out of 10, how many times will I get it right? That's my hit rate. And then what is my risk reward ratio? And you multiply it by it. So to make it very brief and simple in layman terms, if my hit rate, I'm flipping a coin, and I'm getting it 7 out of 10 times right. If my risk reward ratio is 1 to 1, meaning if I lose, I lose 1%. If I make, I make 1%. You got it 7 times right means you made 7%.
Right.
You got it 3 times wrong, which means you lost 3%. Your net is 4%. So if you have increased your risk reward ratio, so you made it 2 to 1, I got it 7 times right.
Yes, but
it's 14%. And I lost 1% by 3, that's 3%. I made 11%.
Yes. However, past prediction is not an indicator of future earnings.
I agree.
Or is it?
It is.
It is?
It is, correct. It's not indicative, yes. But as I said, when I look at the charts, I look at psychology. Mm. I consider candles as people. Mm. And people will never change.
Why is that? Because people are emotional, people are...
It's evolution. It's evolution. There's a lot of things, again, I don't want to skew away from the subject and go into conspiracy, but a lot of things that are trendy right now. We see we have, I don't know how many genders, and I don't know what's going on in the market, but evolution is evolution. Like, since cavemen, up till date, if it was the case back in the days, yeah, we've evolved over millions and millions of years to create those genes to be able to move in such a pattern. We cannot just suddenly come and change it right now. Probably it will evolve and change once become half robots in another 100 years, but for now, human beings are human beings.
You mentioned robots. We're now in the age of AI, yeah, as you know, for some time now. There's a lot of ventures out there that are building AI bots, AI crypto bots, not just crypto, Forex as well. I wondered what your take is on this, because in a sense, we can sort of predict in the near future that humans are being replaced by AI. Now, an AI doesn't need sleep, doesn't need food, doesn't need anything like we do. AI can also trade at decimals, to the decimals that we ourselves can't as such. We can, of course, set a decimal we want to, but I'm saying time, like milliseconds. We cannot trade on milliseconds. We're unable to. Do you think that these bots will soon replace us? Do we need to even trade and set stop losses? Can the bots do that for us?
Now, two things. The expert advisors or the bots that are trading on our behalf are, obviously you know that we are teaching them what to do. The good thing about it is that you are eluding emotions. So the bot does not have emotions. Right. So increasing the possibility of you making a winning trade is higher, yes. But taking into consideration that you don't put your money with scammers, a lot of scammers come in the name of bots. Mm. However, they do not have that technology. At the end of the day, you taught the bot what to do. So it is your thoughts, right, into that bot. So who said the guy who put his thoughts into that bot is a strategist or knows what to invest in? Plus, there's a lot of factors that are external that can impact the market at that point that the bot, according to the information it received, cannot translate it and take immediate action. So it does need human intervention. That's in terms of bots, I'm not talking about AI. Okay, self-learning robots that can evolve with time. I'm not the expert in AI to give you an answer, but it makes me wonder about one thing, that if I have multiple AIs, are they gonna trade against each other? Mm. Who's gonna be smarter, your AI or my AI? Mm-hmm. Mm. You see, once we are trading, If you are in the buy, I'm in the sell, we are opposite to each other. Most probably, when you are making, someone else is losing.
Yeah.
And when I'm making, someone else is losing, right?
Or profiting.
Or profiting.
Yeah.
As we said, it's a net zero game.
Mm.
So when AIs jump into the game, what's going to happen?
Mm.
Is it a trader's brawl for AIs?
It's an interesting concept, because I will say this, you're right. What your point there is that there has to be a buyer and seller in order for a trade to exist.
Yes.
Otherwise it will not. But each bot has their own instructions set by the user. For example, my budget. And also you may set your stop loss and your range. You know, you can set that. So that range, that stop loss, those instructions will differ from that other person's bot.
So what is it? What is your question exactly? Do you want to invest in bots? Because at the end you need to know who created that bot, right?
Yeah.
It's his strategy. Mm. And then again, he'll show you a track record, which is very easy to be done from the back end. Even you can use, what is it called? I can't remember. FX. Where you see records. I can't remember it. Once I remember, I'll let you know. But even you can manipulate your records.
Really?
FX books, my FX books.
Oh, my FX books.
Yeah, you can manipulate your records.
Manipulate it.
Of course you can manipulate your records. Mm. If you own a brokerage, you can just do it from the back end.
Do it for yourself. So you could do that with SupremeFX?
I can do that with SupremeFX.
Oh.
But I wouldn't, but I can.
I appreciate the honesty.
Exactly. I wouldn't expose myself if I was doing that.
Let's talk more about SupremeFX. So your main product is CFDs, Contract for Difference.
Correct.
Just for the audience's sake, what is a CFD?
So Contracts for Difference is a contract that resembles the underlying asset. So let's say you are trading in stocks, equities. You do not trade the actual stock. Mm-hmm. You do not have, you see, the Central Securities Deposit System does not register that stock in your name.
Mm-hmm.
You are just speculating on the price. So you are betting on the movement of that contract, which is a type of derivatives,
yep,
that it will move in that direction so that you benefit with from the difference of pricing.
Yes, I know this because before I got into crypto, I was using eToro, very well, yeah, well used platform, social platform.
SupremeFX, yeah.
I was using eToro because it had that social feature. You know,
yes,
you could post a status. You
correct
could also follow.
Correct.
Actually follow.
Copy trading and all that.
Copy trading. So I used to trade Bitcoin there, made some good profit, but I was never holding the actual Bitcoin.
Correct.
I wanted to hold the actual Bitcoin in my wallet. So that's fine. It was a good entry point into trading, learning dynamics. But yes, what rightly said, you do not own the actual asset. Now, question to you, is it better to own the actual asset than the reference to the underlying asset?
Now look, whenever you're owning the underlying asset, you can hold it for a way longer period of time, regardless of market dynamics and market movements.
Mm.
Because you don't pay swap charges the way you pay on contracts for difference.
Right, so
contracts for difference are leveraged. What is a leverage? Which means, theoretically, you are taking a loan from a bank that is offering you that leverage so that you can multiply your winning trades,
mm,
as well as your losing. Okay? So you have to pay an interest rate for that. So that is what swap fees, they are overnight charges.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine yourself holding on to a stock because your convention says you are bullish on it on the next 6 months.
Mm.
You might lose all your profits paying it into swaps. So if you are a long-term trader, it's better to hold your investments in the actual, equity. And the other thing is that you don't get to leverage the actual stock. You might, if you go to a bank and you have private banking facilities, you can get 2x, 3x, but you have to pay for that loan as well.
That's, yep, well said. And do you think that's, so based on what you just said, SupremeFX only does CFDs or other products too?
So SupremeFX, as we speak, is only CFDs.
Okay.
However, we have huge plans into moving to different, to diversify our services, including moving into a hedge fund, asset management, which we already have a license for it, and offering the 1X, which is the way eToro offers you. If you just put 1X, you manage to have the actual stock.
Mm.
So it will be registered in your name. So that's for our future plans. But at the in the meantime, it's only CFDs.
Got it. How did you start SupremeFX? Tell us the story.
interesting enough that as a chartered wealth manager, you see, I started from very humble beginnings, maybe less than humble. I come from Saida, which is a very small city in Lebanon, and where we were not very fortunate financially. Okay, so I had a tough life growing up, and I was very ambitious all my life. I managed to work with a lot of, or God gave me the opportunity to be between a lot of mentors and between a lot of people who have the business acumen. When I saw what they deal in, I was inspired. I was actually a trainer, gym trainer.
Oh,
yeah,
nice.
Yeah, I was
PT.
A
cert. Personal
trainer? PT, yeah, PT.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah, I used to run two gyms. I used to offer, of course, different supplements. And I wanted to compete before I ripped my chest.
Oh.
I have a pectoralis major rupture. But God's plans are always the best plans. So God decided that, no, this is not for you. I immediately got an opportunity to travel. I traveled. I got exposed, as I said, with a lot of politicians, a lot of ultra high net worth individuals. So I learned a lot from them, which I'm grateful to God and my mentors. And I decided to become a chartered wealth manager. When I became a chartered wealth manager, I said, how can I leverage my gains? I mean, at a young age, I always say, increase your risk with little money. When you become more seasoned, lower your risk with bigger money.
Mm-hmm.
So at a stage where I had little money on my hand, I needed to leverage and I needed to increase my risk. So trading CFDs was one of those ways. Mm-hmm. At the beginning, I blew a $10,000 account. Okay. Mm-hmm. However, I persevered, which a lot of the people who trade, and I like to tell this to our audience, that do not give up. It's a, I don't know a higher paying skill than trading. It's a very high paying skill, but you need to have skin in the game. Then I became the CRO, Chief Risk Officer, for companies that deal in physical gold trading, which gave me that competitive edge because it was my job to forecast the gold price so that I can hedge against market turmoils. Today, if you buy physical gold from Africa, let's say at the price of $2,000, by the time in 2 weeks that it reaches to sell it to the retail here in the market, it reaches the price might fluctuate 2-3%. On a $200 million weekly turnover, imagine the impact of our loss. So I needed to hedge using different platforms or optimize the profitability if I was forecasting a different price and be patient before I hedge. That was my job. I did it successfully at a young age. I managed it and I saw that all that money is going to the broker because we were hedging a lot with the broker. And I started calculating how much is the broker making. That inspired me, vertical integration. I started my brokerage and I told the physical trading companies, hedge your positions with me. I dealt with a lot of high net worth individuals who I managed their assets using a different platform. I said, why on a different platform? Let it be my own platform. And that's how the journey started.
Wow, inspiring, very inspiring.
Thank you very much, thank you.
Just to understand, you went from, you said $10,000? You started
which I wiped out.
Which you wiped out.
It went down to 1,000, I gained another 1,500 and I withdrew the money then.
What did you start with before this 10,000? How did you start? Or you started with some capital in the beginning?
Yes, because I was working, right? When
right.
I first traveled, I told you, I was a recreation manager for Sun Africa Hotels, okay? And I was a personal trainer to the high net worth individuals there.
Wow. So whatever savings you made.
Exactly, and I was hustling. I started a farm, I started a consultancy firm, which all failed, but I learned a lot. I learned a lot. I used to do my business cards. I did my website myself. I went and registered the company in Africa. You have to go to Sharia House, you know, in Kenya. And I was actually standing in the line between everyone there and waiting for your turn. And then they come, they're saying, we cannot register it for you, which means you have to grease some elbows. You know, the proper rough style.
Wow.
Yeah, then I learned a lot. I did also digital marketing. We did well at the beginning, but then slowly but surely I was studying on the side And I decided to become a chartered wealth manager, which gave me a competitive edge, as we said. And I was very, very, very disciplined. I would say that helped me a lot after my belief in God. Because when you have belief in God, I must say that it gives you that that edge. Look, when you believe in a supreme entity, and you know it's that there's someone behind your shoulder no matter what, your mindset becomes invincible. I had maximum discipline, I would never give up for anything. My willpower was impeccable. I would never stop for anything. I was sleeping 3 hours. I got panic attacks sometimes, which I didn't know came from what. It's just because of how much pressure I was putting on my body. But I said, if I want something, and I know everything with God is possible, He created this universe that we're talking about. I could be wrong with the numbers, but 92 billion light years is the radius, I think, of the this universe. Imagine it takes 8 minutes to cross the distance of 150 million kilometers from the sun to Earth. In 8 minutes. When I talk about 92 billion light years, that is God. He cannot give you a wish or grant you a wish that you're asking for. To Him, it's nothing. But you have to show that you are a good student. That's why in Arabic he's called Rabb. Like Rab. The father is Rabb al-Bayt, means God is Rabb of everything. So just like you are with your father, you show him that you are good so that you get a bicycle. You get good grades to get that bicycle when you were a student or a kid at school. You have to do the same with God. Show Him I'm a good person. Okay, I have good intentions. I'm working harder than anyone I know. Do I not deserve it? Why would God, the most generous, say no to you? He will say, take my son.
I like this transition to faith, because faith is still a very important mental part for any person. Whenever they, what keeps them going despite the hardships? Something needs to keep you going, and faith is one of the most powerful things known to humanity. And some people lose it, give up, but some people keep it and make something out of it and not waste it. Coming back to your entrepreneurial journey, how many failures did it take before you made SupremeFX?
No, not like it's not like I was counting my failures, right? I mean, it does get frustrating sometimes. I'm a human being. Yeah. Okay, you will say, why this, why that, you know? I'm doing my best, what's next? But look, when you're not born rich, there's a specific, you know, there's like a roof, there's a ceiling that you really need to break through. You know, it's like you hit, you come back down, you hit. Yeah. It's like resistance in trading.
Yeah, it is. It's like a resistance.
Yeah, it keeps, you keep on trying, but with perseverance, it's like that drop of water. I saw a Chinese motto, the drop of water that is hitting the stone. And they show you the erosion over time and how that stone becomes carved with time. Water cannot break a stone, but with time it can create erosion and break the stone, right? The rock. So similarly with you, these are examples. Like the diamond is coal, both are carbon, but under pressure, it became a diamond. And same human beings, you have to keep on hitting, and one day it will just stop. And when it rains, it pours. Right? So that's how it works.
Right. I'm curious to know. So now, is it now that you manage 50 million? Because that was in your bio. I want to talk a little bit about how much you managed once as a wealth manager.
So that was a couple of years back, and there's a lot of things when it comes to managing people's money. You can do a suitability test and a financial assessment, and you can understand the people's psychological makeup. Some are risk averse, some have risky natures. But with time, you will start noticing that you cannot predict how would a human being react against turmoil or hardships. When you are trading, and my clients had access to my accounts read-only, so they could watch what I'm doing. My style of trading is similar to the mercantile, so I don't put a stop loss per se. I don't advise this to any of the beginners, yeah? They have to put a stop loss. This, with time, you can only come up with a strategy that suits your psychological makeup and is a winning strategy for you, then you stick to it. But when I was doing that, I would get a drawdown sometimes. When I stick to it, I eventually come up, I come out as a winner. But I've noticed that there was a lot of going back and forth with my clients over that. So they were always, why this is down, why this? That's one part of it. Not to mention that 70% of their portfolio is up. But they're looking, they're shedding light on the losses. But in total, you are in profit. So relax. If you keep impacting my emotions, I will not be able to survive. I will not be, because it's all about emotions and my psychological makeup. So you need to keep me in a proper frame of mind. Do not intervene. A lot of people start from here and there. It was a bit stressful. So I decided, look, if I'm trading my own money and I'm making good, I don't need it. So I started trading my own money. Speaking of CFDs, the other part was very easy. We looked for distressed properties. We looked for WAWS, different structured notes with banks. That was beautiful. Okay, where you get stocks on a discount. This is actually something that the retail market doesn't know about, but it's open for private banking. Because when you're rich, you just get richer with time, yeah? So you get access to facilities that the retail trader does not have access to. Okay, so we get structured notes with a downside protection of 40%, for example, on Tesla stock, with a fixed coupon note of 15 to 20% annually. So even if that on maturity, the structured note matured and the Tesla stock wasn't lost, below 60%, which is 40%, and the 20% fixed coupon note that you are receiving, you can still ask for delivery of the stocks and hold it. So your risk is minimized. It's about diversifying the client's portfolios, which made me very successful and gain a very good reputation in the market. That's why I managed 50 million in a blink of an eye. I started gathering those high net worth individuals that I dealt with. But the CFDs part of it was stressful. That's why I moved to the brokerage and I trade my own money. I actually trade, today I have positions. I make an average weekly of around the 20% up and down, okay? So I'm doing well for myself trading. I don't need to trade people's money.
No, that's much better. No, you went from a place where first you have to start with experience. You have to start working for someone.
You have to leverage.
Of course. Nobody has it already done for them because you had to learn from somebody. So in the beginning, you started from that point. And me too, before having this podcast, I was doing it in my home. You know, home setup was nothing like this.
Agreed.
It took time. And then now, you're at a position where, why do I need to trade other people's money when I can do my own? Yes, it may not be 50 million, but who cares? Whatever I make
is for me. You never know.
You never know. Keep it like that. But when you did trade 50 million, were you in a team? Were you part of other wealth managers? Or was it just you managing that?
What part of it?
The whole 50.
Like CFDs or the because private banking, of course, you go back and forth with investment advisories, and you are the fund manager, so you are the front line, and you go back and forth talking to your clients and talking to the investment advisories, looking for proper products with different banks, okay, and with real estate agents, depending on where you want to diversify your money into, okay. But when it comes to CFDs, yes, we had a research team, okay. But it wasn't like they were sending calls, okay? We would discuss it. We were a group of very well-connected people, a small circle. We know each other very well, okay, where we discussed. But at the end of the day, execution was up to me. I had to take the decisions.
Right, right. And you would choose how much stake to buy in a company and what price to buy at, things like this, all of this.
I had to take the risk. Of course, I talk to my clients.
Of course, yeah.
Because it's very important to understand, to establish rapport and understand your client's risk profile. Okay, because he might not be able to handle it if it goes wrong.
Of course.
You will not get all winning trades, right? But so I was taking the decision after I had sat down, explained it to my professional clients that this is the risk. However, this is the reward, relatively very safe. This is high risk. You're at this age, this is your time horizon. This is your financial commitments. We can get into this trade because it will help us, for example, close these financial commitments, keep this for your savings. Mm. It's financial planning.
Right, right. There's a clause, I believe, as I understand, there's a legal clause that says even if, you know, your trade were to go wrong, you know, the client themselves would have to take responsibility for that. You get paid a management fee, is that correct? Fund managers are paid a management fee regardless of the markets. It's a client advisory fee. And then if they make any profits, they also earn a commission on that. Is that correct?
So it depends on where you're putting your money. So if it's a hedge fund, there's usually a watermark structure, which is 20% of everything you make above the record percentage you've made for the last 3 years. So let's say over the past 3 years, you were making 5% annually. Anything above 5%, you've put your money in that hedge fund because you're expecting 5% annually.
Right.
Okay. After, when you handle people's money, if you made, let's say, 5%, you make 20% of that extra 2%.
I see.
That's how it works, usually in hedge funds. Investment advisors, as you said, there's usually a brokerage fee for when you buy the stocks. And in general, there's a 1% management fee. The moment you enter, it's charged on you.
Right, right.
But obviously, when you start making winnings, people will invest more.
Of course.
And as an investment advisor, you are getting that 0.5% or 1%, depending where the product is.
Yeah, 0.5% of a billion. That's
correct.
Wow.
That's how it works.
In your pocket.
That's how it works.
And were you taxed on this? I'm just curious, where were you doing this?
Depending on the jurisdiction,
yeah.
Of course.
The jurisdiction that you were at, was it taxed?
Well, here in Dubai, you are not taxed.
You're not taxed. Wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful. When did you make that switch from working for somebody to now working for yourself? How long ago was this?
Well, look, around 9 years, I started working for myself, but I was still, I'm being very transparent about my life. So for 9 years or 10 years, I was still, look, when you establish a relationship with those high net worth individuals, this is a relationship. So if they ask you to do something, you will have to still do it. So you're working for and with them in a way, especially being an independent advisor who has his hands into different investment advisories. So I bring the clients and I advise, I want this product. No, I want this product from here. I want this product from here. You're offering this. You're working with the Bank of Singapore. I want this product. What about you? So I decide. Okay. However, whenever the people ask for different things, like I have some clients used to ask me, Samir, please go check for me. I want a private jet. Okay. Or I want a private jet like concierge and things like that. I was doing, but I moved to SupremeFX 4 years back, where I sit in an office, working from an office, my office, so 4 years back.
Got it. No, good to get an indication, an idea.
Yeah.
4 years doing this. I think we talked a little bit about...
But don't forget, 9 years back, I had my business consultancy firm, my farming, which is 9-10 years ago, all that was my own. But as I said, I was always doing favors for others, okay? Which kept me also, because I was on a retainer also with them, which kept me in a way that I am entitled to do that job for them.
And all those previous businesses, are they closed? Closed down?
I have an office in Kenya.
Okay.
Okay, but it's not, just in case one day I want to go back there.
Uh-huh.
I know I have an office, but it's not, we're not offering any services as we speak.
Okay. No.
It's very difficult in Africa. It's not the conventional way.
Mm.
You have to arm wrestle a lot with a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Wild West.
I can imagine. I've never been there. But,
yeah. It's beautiful. You have to go and visit.
Mm.
Beautiful safari, beautiful life, beautiful everything. The greenery, the air you breathe there. Wow. You actually feel so fresh there. But it comes at a price.
Mm, I can imagine. Setting up a brokerage firm, I think it's correct to call your firm a brokerage.
Correct.
What were the licensing like? Because I know there can be quite high fees. Licensing, but also ongoing fees. Maybe you have to hire a compliance officer to report to the regulatory authorities. Walk us through the legal and the bureaucracies of this.
Now, this is a bit of business secrecy, but it takes some time. It can take 6 months. It can take a year to get your license.
Wow.
Okay. It can take sometimes more than a year, depending on the documents that you submit to the regulatory bodies and depending on the jurisdiction. So in Seychelles, for example, so to say, it was a little trickier than to get it from Mauritius, for example.
Where I'm from.
Okay, where you're from. Yeah. Okay, beautiful country, by
the
way.
Thank you so much.
And I know that it has a bright future. Like, I know a lot of business is going on in Mauritius. However, in Dubai, it's even more difficult. To get it from DFSA or from the ADGM or ESCA license is also trickier. So I guess with all, this is a sovereign license, so Seychelles might say Dubai is grey listed, you cannot get clients, for example, from Dubai. But so what? I mean, most of the countries in the world were grey listed. I could be wrong, but I think Canada was one time grey listed. A lot of those countries were actually grey listed. So it is a sovereign thing, but Dubai is a little harder to get it, and the capital requirements are higher. So if it would cost you around $250,000 in Seychelles, here it would cost you a bit more with the paid up capital, you know, that you need to keep as a reserve with the bank and so forth.
So you're registered in Seychelles?
One of our entities, yes, is in Seychelles, and we have submitted here in Dubai. God willing, we are expecting very soon to be regulated by ESCA.
So it's a new venture. Oh, I mean,
it's a new venture, it's part of the group, SupremeFX group.
Right. Why do you want it from ESCA when you have some Seychelles?
Look, we live in an era where there's a lot of scammers due to the flexibility and accessibility into social media platforms and the internet, the highway of information. You always, although as a credible person who has experience, with all due respect, unlike many of those influencers in the market that are 19 years old, 20 years old, that talk about financial literacy with minimum experience, okay, you have to understand that trading comes with experience. Okay, so it does require experience. I've seen the ups and downs in the markets. I've burned my fingers several times. I've lost $300,000 in a day.
In a day?
In a day, trading.
Your money?
My money.
Wow.
I've made more, but I lost in one day $300,000. I don't think, as I said, Warren Buffett with 100 something billion, while someone else trading with 1 million, there's a big difference. So I don't think the newbies in the game are trading with such big amounts. They don't have the skin. They don't have the heart to deal with big amounts. So they don't have the actual experience that we have. But let's not talk about myself. I'm just talking about the environment right now in this industry. There's a lot of scammers and a lot of opportunists, I would say. Maybe they're not scammers, but they take advantage of the current environment. And what happens is that, oh, your company is registered where? It's in Seychelles, it's offshore. Okay, I know Samir. I will come because of Samir. Mm. But I feel more comfortable dealing with someone, for example, in the UAE. Speaking of the clients of the UAE, okay? So for that reason, we said, okay, since we are based here, okay, we have a representative office here. We already applied. Our office is now in DIFC. We have already applied. It makes sense to have a license locally so that people feel more comfortable. However, this is for the audience. If someone wants to scam you, they're not gonna wait for ESCA license or SEC license. If they wanna do it, they can still do it. That's why, as Warren Buffett says, where you're putting your money, look at the leadership. And that's why on social media, I try to be very visible so that people see. I have no conflict of interest with you. I'm a broker, come trade with me. Your withdrawals will be met in time. I actually also give signals. We have different Telegram signals group. Oh, we offer it for free.
Oh, nice.
Okay, they are my signals, so that people can almost copy paste what I'm doing.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so you can do that too.
Yeah,
by the way,
yeah? Of course.
And my high net worth individuals also do it. Some of them, they enjoy the adrenaline of trading. They like to do it themselves. I just send them the signals and they trade. And actually we have some prominent names with us, without mentioning names, in case they don't feel comfortable.
Yeah.
but we have a lot of prominent names with us who trade and follow those signals. So as I said, it's for credibility and for the consciousness and comfort of our local people here.
I suppose it's also good to have a diversity. You have Seychelles, good, that's one market. You have Dubai as well, that's another market. And you have that certificate to prove, like, look, we're here, we have the license. So we're a legit company. There's nothing you can say.
Agreed.
The only thing is, like you said, the capital requirements, the paid up thing, and I suppose, do you need to hire an ongoing cost of a compliance manager?
Of course, we have a compliance officer.
Oh, wow.
That is the whole time checking our CRM, making sure that every transaction, the way it's moving, is it coming from the bank? Mm. Okay, it goes to their account. What's the name of the account, number of the account? Mm. Did you do the KYC for the client? So it's proper, like a proper bank. It's a financial institution. Mm. The way it's conveyed in this market nowadays, I feel like it's a casino, the way you said it.
Right.
Okay, but it's a financial institution.
Yeah. So I'm just curious, you know, you some people, you know, the generation that I think after mine, okay, 2000
generation
people who were
Z.
Born Generation Z, let's say. These people, some of them make millions off meme coins. You've heard of meme coins, Shiba Inu, Dogecoin, of things course. Like this. They're managing assets above 300K. They have made millions on this and more. You know, why need to start a brokerage firm to trade other people's money when you yourself can trade your own money and you don't need to set up any firm and pay any compliance officer and pay any licensing fee and pay any legal? Why set up an institution?
Two things. First of all, Adil, I think you missed the point that we do not manage people's money as a broker.
Sorry, yes.
Okay, so that is something. And as I said, I am managing my own money.
Yeah.
And I'm doing very well for myself. And I trade live sometimes on YouTube. I go, I open, and I open the trade and people look, this is my account, this is how much I'm making. You can do the same. Please just follow what I'm saying and make yourself some bread and butter, okay? But I tell you about the financial institution, it's about creating your legacy. Mm. Number one, it's creating an establishment. Mm. It's like an empire you're building. I look at life like Monopoly. You know, you start building houses, then you move to the next street, you buy more houses, build hotels here, like that.
Yeah.
So it's your personal legacy, it's an establishment, and the people who are trading meme coins, once this trend is over, just like any other trend in the past, let's see what they will do.
Mm.
Okay, with all due respect, they might be geniuses, I don't know. Well, I'm not talking about someone in particular, right? Mm. I'm sure there are very smart and brilliant, bright people there who are doing great. Okay, but meme coin has no fundamental.
No, none.
I would understand Bitcoin. I understand Ethereum with the smart contracts. I actually used in Kenya, because I know we're running out of time, but I used, we had State Token Trust. This was a company I was, creating in Kenya using the smart contracts. We're creating a real estate investment trust, so tokenizing real estate using smart contracts for the distribution of profits and for the registration of the asset ownership and so forth on the blockchain. So there is a use case for the blockchain itself. I think that's where the money is. Bitcoin as an asset, I wouldn't compare it to gold, but as an asset of freedom, probably. Again, I don't want to jump into conspiracy theories, but those people are trading meme coins. Whoever is trading with them, most probably, I don't know if they are happy or not, but the risk is too high to bear. Gold can never go to zero. It's impossible, gold to go to zero. But a meme coin can vanish. Stocks are safer. Stocks, there's an established company. There's Microsoft, service, products, Apple. What is a meme coin doing? Your speculation, pure casino. Mm. That's where the casino is. Technical analysis, but we've seen Luna when it dropped. I know many people who lost a fortune, okay? There's a lot of those coins where people lose. There's no backup. There's no backup for this asset. If you want to speculate and try, why not?
Yeah.
Do it. You're young, you have extra money, you want to give it a try, up to you. But it's not, I cannot advise it as a financial asset.
You mentioned gold. You can't stop talking about gold. So I want to talk about your nickname.
Yeah.
The King of Gold. Is that correct? Is that the nickname?
Well, I don't like to get into these titles, but it's actually something that started as a joke. I'm a member of the Capital Club.
Uh-huh.
So every time I walked in, oh, the King of Gold has arrived. The King of Gold has arrived. The King of Gold has arrived. So it uh-huh. became like a nickname for me here in the financial industry, and I'm using it.
I see.
Yeah.
I want to understand. Gold, I understand, is an asset that has a limited supply in the whole world. Do you concede that Bitcoin is the new digital gold because it also has a fixed supply of 21 billion, I believe, in the whole world, 21 million. Do you see that as the next digital gold? What's your opinion on it?
Look, I don't consider it the next digital gold. Okay, but I do consider it. I'm one of the advocates to a certain extent of Bitcoin. I bought Bitcoins, I was buying in 2018.
Oh, good.
My average price of buying Bitcoin is 12,000 between all the Bitcoins, dollars. So I started buying at 2,000, 4,000, 3,000, 5,000, I was buying Bitcoin. So because I do have an acumen and I have that touch in the conspiracy theories, and I do believe the One World agenda and its direction and the future, I do think that it is good. And now we have the Bitcoin ETF by BlackRock. I do see the adoption taking place. So I do think that Bitcoin is a financial asset, whether we like it or not, whether Warren Buffett doesn't like it and many others don't, it is now officially an ETF. But I wouldn't say it is gold. Gold will remain gold. I don't know, in the future we might get a blackout, a cyber attack. Okay, having your Bitcoins in a cold wallet would be a great idea. Okay, but would it be gold? I don't think anything would substitute gold. So diversify. Diversify.
That's a very fair statement. Do you have any gold bullions that you actually keep?
Yes, I do.
In your place?
Yes.
Ah, that's an interesting.
Not in my place. You don't know where I live. but of course.
Yeah. I suppose gold, I understand why it's been around much longer, but also, there was the gold standard back then, but then it got abolished in 1970.
Yeah, in 1972.
Unfortunately, because there isn't enough gold to make the world turn. There isn't. And unfortunately, that's the reason why they couldn't continue with gold. They had to print money, quantitative easing, because that is what makes the world go round. You can always pay your debts with it. That's what they always increase their debt ceiling every year, the US.
Correct.
But gold, unfortunately, cannot. So for that reason, that's the reason why gold has its value, because it's limited.
I agree. Now, talking about President Nixon's Bretton Woods in 1970, 1972, when they removed gold as the reserve dollar was pegged on gold. They print a lot of money. The Congress keeps on lifting the ceiling for printing money. So they keep on paying debts with that. So it's built on trust. The US dollar is built on trust. That's why you see In God We Trust. And it's just, I don't know which God they trust in, but yeah. But they keep on printing and printing and printing. Okay, they're just pushing the can down the hill.
Yeah.
Okay, until they reach and they bang their heads. So it's a dying, it's my opinion. I think it's a dying country, right, slowly but surely.
Yeah.
They will most probably, create World War III or something just to shake up the whole thing again. But the dollar now is actually a paper. It's only pegged on that most of the commodities in the world are traded with the US dollar. So the demand is actually extremely high on the US dollar.
Mm-hmm.
Recently, we've seen the yuan gain its place in the currency market. I could be wrong, but this is what I remember the numbers are. 52%, I think, of the Chinese transactions now are done by the yuan, moving from around 1%, and the rest were in dollars. They're actually now buying and selling commodities with Russia and India using the ruble, the Indian rupees, and the yuan. Taiwan not long ago joined the basket of currencies. Not long ago, I think it's at 1%. You can all do your research. I'm often wrong. Okay, so which is showing you that even now there's a different financial system that they are starting to use, the BRICS countries, including KSA. We saw Biden travel to see His Highness MBS, and it wasn't the best relationship they used to have in the past. So we can see there's a major shift in the world happening right now.
Major
shift that is threatening the dollar. And that's why we can see they're instigating on different fronts war. Like there was a major intervention in Ukraine-Russian war. Now we can see with Israel against Palestine. I'm a pro-Palestine person. Okay. I'm half Palestinian. My mother is Palestinian. Okay. We can see that they are opening many fronts. There's something coming up.
You mentioned KSA. That's a fair point. KSA recently decided not to continue and renew their contract with the U.S. in terms of when they sell oil, it has to be the U.S. currency.
Correct.
Now they can sell
petrodollar.
Petrodollar. That's right. That was a really interesting signaling that the U.S. may not become the world's reserve. Right now,
it happened, Adil, in the past it happened. The GBP was the strongest currency in the past, and it took, I think, 70 years in total to move into the US dollar. The guilder was also one of the strongest currencies in the past, and we've seen a shift throughout. Before the Romans, the Roman coin, and slowly but surely getting into wars, they start financing, they start mixing copper with the gold. Slowly the inflation has always been there, and the devaluation, depreciation of currencies has always been there, and it exists and it still exists. So I wouldn't be surprised to see another shift soon from the US dollar. It will take time. I mean, it's not gonna happen tomorrow the way people are going. They're going crazy, the dollar is collapsing. Relax, the dollar is not yet collapsing, but it's on the verge. Yes, we can see the economical and fundamental, you know, outlook shows us that the dollar is in trouble. I mean, the debt is in trillions of dollars skyrocketing, but it doesn't mean it's gonna happen tomorrow.
Right. But in God they trust.
In God they trust.
We have to leave it there. But I really learned a lot from you in this conversation.
This is mutual. Thank you very much.
I really want to ask for one last message. Maybe you could send to the audience for those out there. You know, the children, those who are beginning their lives. Okay, those who are making a choice. Do I go to university and become a worker, a 9-to-5, whatever? Do a degree, or do I start something of my own now? What would be your advice?
I'm gonna make this very clear because I really appreciate your question. It is now very popular by many big influencers on social media, including Andrew Tate and other influencers, saying, screw that college degree, screw this, screw that, screw depression, screw this. Don't drop out of school. Actually, school benefited me a lot. I speak history, I speak geography. I'm very well educated because of school. I was an A-star student in school also. I learned a lot from school, and not everyone can be a businessman. The entrepreneurial career is not for everyone. Yes, it offers you an edge, but it comes with a sacrifice. Choose what you love to do. You want to be a football player? Don't choose the easier way. Don't choose the easier way, but choose what you love to do so that you can grow interest. And yes, you will not be working a single day more in your life, because when you are doing what you love, you feel great about it. But if you want to be a doctor, you want to be an engineer, you want to have specified knowledge about specific topics, college, universities is the way to go. You need to learn from an expert how to do it. Not everyone can be an entrepreneur, as I said, and not everyone can take that risk. Not everyone has a psychological makeup. You are fantastic on hosting. you have your charisma and you're doing great in your field, Adel.
Thank you.
Maybe I can't do what you are doing, but I'm sure I can do better than you in trading.
100%.
Each has their different paths. So don't choose your path based on someone on social media is advising you. Find, look into yourself from within. And one thing I advise everyone, not to lose faith. Whatever your religion is, whatever your religion is, God is one, okay? Never lose faith in God. And whenever you feel down, know that there is a supreme entity by your shoulder to always pick you up. So depend on him.
Thank you for that. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Adel.
No, that was very, a pleasure. It comes from the heart. I can feel that. And passion. So I think that advice will go very well for those who are struggling with making a decision because they're getting too much distraction with social media.
Agreed.
Too much like, I want to break out of this matrix, you know, by Tate and podcasters.
Yeah.
But this is well said.
Thank you.
So with that said, thank you so much for watching. We will leave all the links in the description below. Please check out Samir's LinkedIn profile, Instagram. We'll leave all the social media there. Also, SupremeFX. If you're into trading, use their brokerage firm. Go for them. But with that said, I hope you found this insightful. And thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next time. Cheers.